Excellence is a way of life, and it's more so in surgery, and especially in surgical research, because ethically done, good surgical research will go a long way in improving care of the patients and also their recovery in terms of the outcome, reduced morbidity and reduced mortality. Therefore, research needs to be streamlined into ethical and correct methods of doing it to make it useful for the patient and also for the surgeon. Surgery is the most dangerous activity of legal society, and most surgeons live dangerously, as they say. Operation theatre is the most dangerous place in the world. You'll be surprised, during a stint at Sri Lanka during a war zone, one observed that making an operation theatre in a kitchen of a forest officer's bungalow was less infective than probably my own theatre today, because of the kind of bacteria that stay captive within and which have bacterial resistance and can actually cause havoc. One can take a leaf out of the US military, which is considered the best and the best oiled machinery that is operating in the world. Their ways and protocols and SOPs are followed world over. And they actually had put the Operation Excellence into place long ago. And it's a write-up by Colonel Bender, who's a retired US Army Lieutenant Colonel, who actually had worked in the wartime in Vietnam and Korean Wars. And he had written down this entire story of excellence in the army and how do they create SOPs and actually put them to practice. The standard operating procedure should be a protocol in any working scenario in the operation theater, and all surgeons should be trained into following these protocols. So surgery is all about working hard to create protocols, but then more importantly sticking to them. This created what is called the OODA loop, which means observing, orienting, deciding, and then acting. So first observe, then orient yourself to that scenario, that case, condition, the working atmosphere, then take a decision, and then only you should act. It shouldn't be the other way around, that you already acted and the observation happens at the tail end, which can be dangerous. So how do you achieve excellence in surgery? It requires a range of clinical, interpersonal and management skills. A surgeon is a complete man in terms of his capability to be able to manage a team, be a team leader, be a grassroots worker, be a person in the backwaters, be the person in the front waters, and be the person who actually implements his own protocols. So effectively, he has to learn to live and die with his decisions. So it requires clinical, interpersonal and management skills, something which one learns as he grows as a surgeon. And if working in a good unit where one is exposed to these skills, it is easier to pick up. And of course, medical technical expertise and clinical decision making, which is the backbone of anything that happens in surgery. You couldn't be putting any decisions into place without a proper planning and arrangement. Technical expertise and clinical decision making becomes an essential part of management of patients, and also while doing or putting it to use, training your residents into doing the correct way. Bottom line is the most important: communication. And the best mode of communication is listening. And importantly, teamwork, because you should, as a surgeon, know how to make your team work most efficiently. It is often said, if only cuckoos sang in the forest, it will be a silent place. We do not learn for school, but for life. Non schola sed vita decimus. This is a very important lesson to be learned. So we do not learn for school, but for life. School is a place to learn, but not for school. This is a lesson that you take in life. To take an example of our own gurukuls in the past, all the kings, the beggars, all were trained there in the same place. Krishna and Sudama were batchmates and colleagues. One was a very poor man and the other one was a prince coming from a royal family. So they got to live together and understand the living of each other, and they were trained into living their life outside in whatever condition they were exposed or whatever the conditions they faced in life. So it's not that they learnt it for the gurukul, they had learnt it for life. And needless to say, they lived different lives. The results in surgery depend on doing, deciding, and the last one is destiny. Now, I put destiny at the end, otherwise you'll start with it, like we blame it on destiny all the time. But I'm not taking destiny completely away. I'll not be unrealistic in saying that we always create our destiny each time, every moment. We do in a way, but not completely. So there's more to it than what meets the eye. So doing it is primarily important, regardless of what result you're expecting or you're getting. Then deciding as to what to do, and destiny. These three D's are extremely important in the making of a surgeon. Now we can learn our lessons from the cockpit of a plane. I had the joy of flying a proper Airbus simulation in Canada, and that's where the pilots train in terms of the number of hours, and they need to complete so many hours before they are actually allowed to fly. And this gives a virtual feeling which is as close, almost the same as flying. Following this, flying becomes relatively an easier experience. So what lessons do you learn from the cockpit? One, there is a checklist they prepare. Everybody, regardless of the numbers of experience, has to stick to the checklist. We have a WHO checklist and we make it a point to always announce our names of the assistant of the anesthetist during surgery to complete the checklist and to sign it. It has to be signed by all. We know who is the patient, identify the site, what surgery was planned, who is the first surgeon, who is the assistant, etc., etc. The checklist has to be ticked and we follow it as a routine protocol in our unit. Now, what was the aviation learning? You must realize this. In the US airline, fatality rate was 1/5 of 1950. So they brought it down to 1/5, which is a huge gain. And mind you, no one died in a domestic airliner in 2002 to 2004. This is the data I got from the US aviation website. So since 1950, the accident rate per 1 lakh flying hours has been cut by over 87%. So you can imagine the gain that the way it helped in planning it. Now the view from aviation, they estimate that up to 23,000 people died in 2004 in Canadian hospitals because the preventable adverse events is staggering indeed. Checklists have been used in aviation to standardize and increase the reliability of systems. One wonders whether such checklists would have been introduced much earlier in medicine. Thankfully, we have checklists now. And if surgeons shared the fate of their patients as pilots shared that of their passengers, maybe the outcome would be different. The pilot has to go down with the passengers. The doctor doesn't have to go down with the patient. This could well be a difference. This is a view of a retired pilot, Bolan. And I think to a great degree, these checklists would make a difference. They are making a difference and it's important to adhere to them. Surgical safety is indeed a serious issue. And Canadian adverse events study observed that more than 50% of adverse events involved surgery. That's Baker et al. The Healthcare Insurance Reciprocal of Canada reports that since inception, that is 20 years, with most claims occurring in the last 7 to 8 years. So we have gone up. Some also link it to the laparoscopic, endoscopic, and many virtual scenarios coming into play. The surgical claims account for 27 million. 40% would have been prevented with a checklist, or approximately $10 million would have been saved. What are the kind of claims they have got? 210 were retained foreign body. 94 were the wrong body part, and 9 were wrong patient. This is US and Canada. And this is the data from Canada. So you can imagine, if you do not follow the checklist, they are following the checklist, what would happen is very easy to understand. Safety is paramount, and we know that the bottom line in medicine is primum non nocere. Above all, do no harm. Patient safety is definitely compromised by errors, and a lot of them are preventable. Error leads to, should follow it up with error recovery. Now, what is an error? There are two types of errors in surgery. One is the error of execution, and the other one is of planning. Now, what is the error of execution? The failure of planned action to be completed as intended. That's simple. And of planning, use of wrong plan to achieve an aim. So, if you do not have the right plan and you want to achieve the aim, this will be the error of planning. Although the everything is fine, but the action didn't work out, that will be off execution. How would one approach the error? Person-based or system-based? These are the two individual. So there is a benchmarking based on that. The person-based would be naming, blaming, shaming others, which is not a fair deal to go. The system-based, organizational accident. So these are the two approaches to error, the error approach. The common one is system-based organizational accident. This is more common. That is where the system fails, either in terms of the count not happening at the end of the surgery, or the wrong count happening at the end of the surgery, or the identity of the patient not identified by the nursing staff or by the doctor on duty, etc., etc. Now, what are the strengths, therefore, of checklists? Now, one is referring to WHO checklist, if one is referring to it. Deployable in an incremental fashion, so you can deploy it, but not immediately, because most people were initially very resistant to WHO checklist being implemented, and even now, to a lot of people, a lot of our colleagues, it looks like some kind of a sham one is putting up. Supported now by sufficient scientific evidence, and there is an expert consensus, so there is no reason why it should not. Evaluated in diverse settings around the world, ensures adherence to established safety practices, and then minimal resources required. All it needs is a will. And so deployable, supported by evidence, evaluated in diverse circumstances and diverse settings, ensures adherence, it at least ensures that some bit of safety happens, and the minimal resources are demanded. What is the flip side? And I don't blame our colleagues for sometimes calling names. The flip side is sometimes dangerously distracting trainees or ward doctors from life-saving actions, such as going back to theater for stopping the hemorrhage, or should not take the doctor's attention away from life-saving decisions and from main actions to be commenced. Now, the bottom line is very, very important. This is how I look at it. Every action within checklist should serve only as a general guide and must be taken with care, always keeping in mind what the appropriate priorities are in every clinical scenario or in different type of patients. Now, please watch it carefully. This cartoon depicts it all clearly. Everything, the checklist is done, doors closed, checked. No, it's your job to close the doors. Role clarity. There is always a confusion, and everything else would move as per. So the overlap won't happen. So that's the flip side. Overlap won't happen. People won't take another person's position. They would leave it to the same person to do it. If that person doesn't do it, it's difficult to ensure. Now, how do you ensure safety preoperatively? Selecting right operation for the patient and right patient for the operation. Both have many meanings. Because if you don't choose the right operation, you've done a mistake already. The blunder, the disasters are known to happen. And right patient for the operation, check the patient you're operating. When, who, where to operate. Now I'm getting into the serious business of surgery, where the surgeon was interested. Do not rush. Avoid functional lust. And are you sure that you are the best person for the job? You must check it to make sure that you do not compromise on patient's safety. If you cannot do it, call the expert to do it. Always refer. When in doubt, call somebody to help you. Optimizing the patient, rarely one would have to rush in. So it's wrong to assume that a perforation patient needs to be wheeled in. It's this resident who's trying to go home quickly or put it on somebody else. Always optimize the patient. 3 to 4 hours of resuscitation is what is recommended. What is the chief goal in this period is to prevent tissue hypoxia. Patient should not be in shock. Secondly, avoid over-infusion of fluids, especially during intraoperative period where our anesthetist friends can actually overload the patient and bowel edema may happen and the anastomosis can fail. Planning optimum surgery, very important. Always do just about optimum. The punishment, that is the surgery, should fit the crime, that is the disease, and the offender, that is the patient. So do not overkill and don't underdo. The risk and benefit ratio should be less than or equal to 1. Mortality and morbidity is equal to complexity of operation plus acute / chronic health. Bottom line denominator, surgeon's judgment, skills and quality of health care. Anything in surgery boils down to risk and benefit. In the kingdom of surgery, biology is king, selection is queen and technical maneuver is the prince. I would like to quote this. This is Moshe Shian who has written this. I've borrowed it from there. In the kingdom of surgery, biology is king, selection is queen, and technical maneuver is the prince. I've made a little modification, but it's by and large the same. Therefore, in all bowel perforations, we designed this protocol that we must score the patients. In most surgeries, always score your patients. It's not enough to listen to somebody to say that the peritoneal cavity is contaminated. Patient is not too good. The surgeon doesn't look optimum. The conditions are not favorable. Score your patients and use Apache to score for closure. This is what we have used, and we brought down mortality from 44% to 4% in small bowel perforations. And what did we adhere to? We found out that those with scores less than 10, that is group 1 Apache, were good enough to be treated in any way. That is, bowel anastomosis could be done, abdominal could be closed. Between 11 and 20, they are likely to fail in terms of leaks. So exteriorization was the modus operandi, and we left the skin open. More than 20, these patients are not fit enough for surgery. So they needed to be optimized for bilateral flank drains, ICU care till they improved to group 2, and then they were managed as such. Well, can you note the mistake here? We have done a stoma and the skin looks closed. It looks neat and clean now, but either the decision to bring the loop out was not correct, so the abdomen was good, or it is bound to fail. Because if for the what reason you had left the, you had got the gut out, which is when in doubt you take it out, the score was not too good. For the same reason, to close the skin would mean creating an anaerobic environment, which may lead to opening up an infection by anaerobes. Spend time on the table. Remember, the post-operative management of the patient starts on the table. When the abdomen is open, you control it. When it is closed, it controls you. Drains. Remember, drains don't function when you need them the most. Now, we have done this randomized controlled study long back in thyroid patients, where we found that drain itself was the cause of drainage, and most of the time the drains were unnecessary. So this study, which had an ISRCTN number, as many other trials that have poured in, and now it goes beyond doubt that drains may not be needed all the time. There is no case for a diagnostic drain anyway. You should not put a drain thinking that it'll let you know what has leaked. And drain itself becomes the cause of drainage, which delays the recovery of the patient, and then drains go places, they can poke into the gut. Remember, most drains in the abdomen close by 48 to 72 hours. They're plugged by omentum, so they're not needed. So don't drain them unnecessarily. Surgical choices. Now the decision making is essentially the key surgical aspect. I often teach my students that a right decision taken late in surgery is a wrong decision, and a negative laparotomy is better than a positive autopsy. It is not our abilities that show what we truly are, it's our choices. To do or not to do? Well, there is no point operating on patients that are not likely to live. They should not die of surgery. It is known that cancer of esophagus, 95%, would be advanced, may not be fit for surgery. Cancer stomach, more than 90%. Cancer pancreas, more than 95% are advanced. Many operated for palliative care with little benefit. One should not be doing it. When you think the patient is not going to benefit, there are so many non-surgical ways of managing these patients which are less morbid and do not cause misery to the patient before the patient has to go. Negative appendectomies to the tune of 25%. If you find nothing, you take the appendix out. I think that era is now gone and it's no longer advised or acceptable. Negative laparotomy rates are approximately 20%, which again is avoidable. With the kind of investigational facilities that we have, it is possible to avoid negative laparotomies. Now, at the same time, is an aggressive approach justified in the management of an aggressive cancer? Remember, certain cancers like colorectal cancers, they're the aggressivists, and their only palliation is surgery. So we need to be aggressive in certain scenarios. But wherever possible, one should balance out between being extra aggressive and not being absolutely doing nothing to the patient. Now, a word about intuition versus formulas. Why are experts inferior to algorithms? Because there is an illusion of additional information, inconsistency. These are two major reasons why algorithms are important. Algorithms are made based on inputs and observation and studies. So intuitions are inferior to formulas. Doubt is not a pleasant state, but certainty is a ridiculous one. So they have to be somewhere in the middle. Must learn from mistakes. Remember, life is too short to learn only from your own mistakes. One must learn to learn from others' mistakes. So if you observe somebody do a mistake, forever remember not to repeat it. There are many mistakes you watch others do. So there's nothing more deceptive than an obvious fact. I did that, obviously, that's not acceptable. And surgery without proper resources is considered bad practice, potentially dangerous and unacceptable. No longer can you say, I did not have diathermy, so I left bleeders inside. Or I did not have a facility for pelvic surgery, I did not therefore have the right operation. You cannot say that my monitor of the laparoscope was not, laparoscopic surgery was not good, so I did an error. It's not acceptable. Maintaining good standards. We have a problem with training, and surgeons must only offer specialized treatment in which they have been properly trained, that is degree sans training. And at the same time, those who are trained but don't have degree are better than those who have a degree and are not trained at all. To do otherwise would be to place the interest of the surgeon above that of the patient, which is not acceptable. This imbalance is never morally or professionally acceptable. And there are associations all over the world that work towards providing excellence in patient care. Now, what is breach of the code of conduct? If you do not stick to a code of conduct, associations, organizations, councils are supposed to take into account how many mistakes they allow. In US, there's a good concept of benchmarking hospitals, benchmarking centers, surgeons. Now, a word about what is actually the boiling point today. Surgeons' response to business models today. We are living in a consumer's world, corporate culture. The shift in attitude towards within the profession is natural. The business jargon has a commonplace. Patients have been replaced by consumers, eventually customers. Customers come to purchase healthcare. So naturally, they convert you, a surgeon into, or convert a surgeon into a shopkeeper. There is no shame in being a shopkeeper, but medical care is not something you can buy across the counter. The less time you spend with the customers, the better your bottom line. It's an important way to avoid it. What is the position of surgeon in business? Please watch it carefully. In business, they are fighting with each other. Dog eating dog. And in academia, it's just the opposite. So, nothing changes. What about excellence in research? Research is a vital part of surgical practice. One must adhere to the ethical guidelines in order to conduct research. It's incumbent upon surgeons to acquire knowledge and skills to apply new techniques and or technology. And as a clinician, you need to wear two hats, one that of a researcher and that of a surgeon. Benefits should always outweigh the risks. Surgeons are the experts. It should be left to them and them only to regulate surgical research. Few would now endorse this view. It was earlier the case, I do it this way, you bloody well do it this way. It's no longer acceptable, pardon me. Ethics in surgical research have brought evidence rather than eminence as the bottom line in practice. Research ethics in any case are evolving science. The responsibility to improve operative techniques through research to assure patients that the care proposed is the best. And the administration of such regulation is through research ethics committees. And what are the pillars of research ethics? Autonomy and informed consent. Confidentiality and autonomy are mandatory. The information a patient reveals to a surgeon is private. It should never be shared. As limits on how and when it can be disclosed to a third party, except in medical-legal cases where again there is a threat, patient and the person treating the patient have right to dignity and there is no way it should be exposed to anybody. Breaking confidentiality is only possible and it's recommended, it's allowed, if the patient is threat to self or others. Psychiatric cases, it is good to expose that this person is got a tendency to develop, to get those fits, can kill others, can damage others, harm others. Improving treatment options, if it is actually helping and in public interest, that patients, so many patients of dengue or the kalazar were caught, so it can be disclosed. Otherwise, confidentiality is very important. What is an informed consent? It's a process in which person agrees to participate in clinical research and complete knowledge of all relevant facts, such as the risks involved or any available alternatives. It is designed to protect individuals participating. This is a Belmont report. Functions of informed consent. It's promotion of individual autonomy, patient participation in rational decision-making, reducing civil or legal liability of clinician and also the institution. Well, you must spend time. The disclosure has to be followed by good understanding. It should be in familiar language, and this triangle would take care of the problem that we face where the patient and a clinician understanding has a problem. Ensure that participant information sheet is filled, consent form is properly in the language that the patient understands, and please do not use Google translation. As you can see, it is a ridiculous translation of what exactly you wanted to actually imply. In a typical North Indian hospital, your child may feel slight pain during blood withdrawal and there is slight chance of bruising at the site of needle puncture, and the translation is quite bizarre. And translate carefully, use professional help if needed. Like when in Rome, do as the Romans. Rome mein ho to Romeo ki tarah raho, karo. That's not a correct translation. Now, what is clinical care? What do you do? And what is in clinical research? Clinical care is basically standard clinical practice in caring for patients. This can be regulated, this should be regulated. But clinical research is definitely to be regulated because it will benefit future patients and society and it will help you deal with the unknown. Regulations are designed to ensure quality and integrity of data collected in clinical trials and studies, ensure that the rights and safety and welfare of the research participants are protected. Well, these are the applicable guidelines. I'll skip through them. They're available on the net. One can always take down the aspects of participation information sheet. I'll skip it. How and what to do. Make a research project scientifically and ethically sound. Be confident that it can be done in stipulated time frame, feasibility and funding. Present your research proposal to screening committee of the institute. If screening committee recommends it for further approval to institutional ethics committee, then it must be presented there. Well, this is generally, it should be followed in the ethical scenarios in all institutions. In most scenarios, in most situations, not only should be the clinical practice be ethical, the research also needs to be ethical. To be excellent in your field essentially requires a very diligent effort to take care of all the possible loopholes. This talk was essentially to cover up some cornerstones which must be handled with care to make sure that not only is the surgical research safe for the patient but also for the surgeon. At the same time, it should be legally, ethically sound and feasible. The purpose of the lecture was to make one aware of the requirements of doing surgical research to achieve excellence in a particular scenario. Thank you all very much.